Happy Employee Week. Happy Nurses Week post 1 week. We're sure glad everybody's here. If any of you had a chance to read my Friday Flash report a week ago, you'll know that I grew up in Central Illinois. And part of growing up in Central Illinois, because there's lots of ice and snow, is that kids get ice skates for Christmas. And my family was no different. We always had ice skates, and we would go out on the weekends in the winter to some frozen lake or frozen pond, and we would ice skate. And some of my best memories as a kid are doing that with my family. One of the favorite videos I have from back then was a video of my sister learning to skate, because she was about 2 at the time, and she was gliding across the ice with my mother's help, and my mom let her go, and she glided about twice and then fell. Of course, she started crying, and my brother and I started laughing. But at any rate, I actually eventually hung up my skates, unlike our speaker today. So in 2004, when I met Casey FitzRandolph, I was thrilled because I had always admired athletes, people who could excel in their sport. He joins us today as a 6-time U.S. national sprint champion and Olympic gold medalist. He's from Wisconsin, where, yes, it gets very cold, so they have lots of ice. And he established new Olympic records in the 500-meter speed skating race at both the 1998 and 2002 Olympics. His 500-meter record from the Olympics still stands today. Maybe one of the fastest people on skates. He put his first pair of skates on at a very young age too, but it was during the winter of 1979 that he responded to an ad for an all-city speed skating meet that would forever alter his course. But I'm gonna let Casey tell you his story. But Casey, I want you to realize we have a lot of things in common. As you hear Casey's story, you're going to realize how much the stories overlap, the perseverance despite incredible odds, coming out from adversity as a winner. I want Casey to know we have many champions here today as well, and I wanted to recognize some of them. First, I want to introduce one of our own UTMB team members, Sandra Powis. Sandra, Stan. She's a UTMB nurse who carried the torch in the Salt Lake City Olympics, and she brought that with her today. So I, but we have many champions. You met some today, and every day, all of these champions, our employees, come to work to work wonders. And it's impossible to capture every single award that everybody had, but we wanted to do some recognitions of some of our folks, because these individuals featured above are in the spirit of our going for the gold. Which was our recognition, our way of recognizing our gold, silver, and bronze medalist recipients from the past year. So congratulations to our gold medalists, many of whom received top nursing recognition, outstanding teaching awards, or were programs or departments that were recognized for their excellence, and we have had many of them this year. Our silver medal recognition was recently upgraded to a gold Get With The Guidelines Resuscitation Award for the American Heart Association. UTMB, it likes to be first, and we were the first hospital in Texas to receive that award. So everybody did a tremendous job. Our bronze medalists include many of our Excellence in Nursing awardees, and our third place recognition at the recent UT System Clinical Safety and Effectiveness Awards. So congratulations to those individuals and so many of others of you who have worked so hard to make sure that UTMB received the recognition that it did. I see a lot of my friends from the revenue cycle, and I was going to mention their history making, because with a little bit of a challenge. I wasn't going to wear skates, but I said I'd wear flip-flops and come work with them if they broke a record for cash last month. And historic cash was collected in April, $10 million above the target, I might add. So congratulations to you all, too. After the presentation, we'd like those of you who are recognized for the various awards that you've gotten to stay and come toward the front, because we're going to have a group picture of Casey with all of our awardees. And following the talk, Casey's going to go out into the foyer and he's going to sign some autographs for everyone, and there'll be some snacks for those of you who might be hungry and have skipped lunch to just to get here. So I want to thank you all for joining us today. I'm going to now turn the time over to have a video introduce Casey, and then he will follow the video with his remarks.
His Olympic dreams began on a frozen pond in Madison, Wisconsin, with hockey skates.
And I didn't like the sweaty, itchy pads that came along with hockey, so I thought that speed skating looked like something I would be interested in.
And he was the only five-year-old to sign up for the competition. Mm-hmm. And so the people that were running the competition said, what do you want us to do? And we said, well, put him in with the 6 and 7 year olds and let him compete with them. And so they said, well, okay, we'll do that. And so he went out and against the 6 and 7 year olds, and in his hockey skates, he still won all three races that he was able to run.
After wowing them in the all-city meet, two prophetic statements. The first from a coach.
He said, you guys have the next Eric Heiden here. And of course, we were parents, and so we wanted to believe it, whether it was true or not. And from that day forward, his successes just continued.
The second from the kid who would later call himself the Cheetah.
I'd like to go to the Olympics and hopefully do what Eric did. Eric Heiden won 5 gold medals.
Even with that dream in mind, his first love was off the ice, enjoying nature, fishing, and hunting.
On the ice, everything is speed, 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 and a hundredth of a second is absolutely critical. Off the ice, he can burn so many hundredths of a second doing absolutely nothing and just laying back and relaxing and being Casey Fitz.
We had him in all these different sports, and even through high school, he played soccer and kicked on the football team, and he decided for himself that he wanted to hone in on the speed skating. And regardless of what he would have chosen to do, we would have backed him on it.
I remember those days,
yeah.
And the weekends that we spent driving around the country and all of the successes that they had. And the thing that was key for us, and I think Ruthie would even agree to this, is that we were there. We got to share in it.
Casey's skills and successes grew. His Olympic dream clearly in his sights. The games in Nagano would be his moment on the medal stand.
In my eyes, more a matter of what color is the medal going to be than am I going to get one or not.
But just months before those games, those darn clap skates came along.
The clap skate is no longer an excuse for not doing well. I can't honestly tell you that I'm where I feel I would have been had they not come along. But I think I'm knocking on the door. I think he believes deep down in his heart that Salt Lake City will be for him what Nagano could have been.
Casey took his Olympic dreams and his fiance north of the border, thinking to be the best, he had to train with the best.
Training in Calgary, but I'm an American, right? And I love America.
Next stop, Salt Lake City, back on his home ice. Another Olympics, another moment to shine.
FitzRandolph is the leader.
Family excited, fans at home pumped, but the Cheetah was just getting warmed up.
I mean, there's really nothing like having a brother in the Olympics. Yeah. It's just an amazing feeling.
FitzRandolph has waited 4 years for this moment.
I can feel it, I'm the world's greatest. Woo! Stop in the sky. Oh, you're yes, I am. I made it. I made it. I'm the whole
I didn't know if I had won overall. But when I finally got confirmation, it was, oh, I felt like the biggest weight that I've ever had on my shoulders had just been lifted.
He didn't know the time he had to beat before he stepped to the line. It's going to be a win, and look at him. Against the blocks. And now he knows.
About. How about the explosion of emotion that comes from Casey's dad and family after the race?
You know, to do it here in America in front of so many friends and family and well-wishers that we don't even know, and in these times makes it perfect. I mean, I couldn't have written a better script in 1980 when I started after watching Eric Heiden.
Think about it. Eric Heiden from Wisconsin, Dan Jansen from Wisconsin, Bonnie Blair, all the great past American speed skaters, at least of the recent past, from Wisconsin. Must be the cheese.
Because the gold belongs to Casey FitzRandolph. Case closed for the men's 500 meters.
It wasn't a sacrifice for us. Everybody says, you know, just think about all the money you could have put in the stock market, FitzRandolph. And I said, yeah, and I could have watched it all crash and burn, too.
It into the kids.
I've got an investment here that's going to last mm-hmm. me a lifetime, and it goes way beyond material things. You know, it is just the greatest blessing of all.
It's a dream come true, and a goal come true as well.
Good afternoon. How are we? Good? Awesome. Well, I can tell you, Jen, stand up real quick. My wife, Jennifer, and I are down, and down from Wisconsin, and we are thrilled to be down here with you, primarily because we're sick of 10 degrees above zero and snow, and I, no, I'm kidding. That doesn't hurt, Donna. Thank you for having us down. We really appreciate it. It has been a real treat for me to get to see Donna again. We've been friends for a long, long time, as well as Kent, her husband, and to be with you over the noon hour here. But I also want to remark on the fact that that Jen and I got a tour of various buildings on campus this morning within the medical branch, and so we had the honor of being able to spend a few minutes with your patients. Certainly not all of them, but patients stemming from miracles of life, 1 pound and change, you know, babies, up through some of your young men and women in their mid to late 80s. And to see, you know, what is being done to help all ends of that spectrum here on campus is really, really impressive. And so my hat's off to you right off the top before I even get into sharing my story and trying to draw some parallels. It's been a fun week for you all, I hope, down here. A fun couple of weeks, from Nurses Week last week to Employee Week this week. And we're at a Friday afternoon, so if anybody runs for the door before I'm done at 1 o'clock, I'll only take partial offense to it. What I want to share my story. My story is really the story of a skinny kid with modest talent, to say the least, who grew up in Madison, Wisconsin. He dreamt of things like becoming the fastest man in the world on ice, of gold medals, of world and Olympic records. And he went on to fulfill those dreams and goals. So it's a story of successes, no doubt. But it's also a story of setbacks. Because I'm a firm believer in what I'm going to call the fact that we simply do not have one without the other. No great successes stem from anything less than a whole bunch of setbacks. And so my journey is going to take, my journey are going to take us on a little bit of a path, sharing the ups, of course, but also sharing the downs. Calvin Coolidge once said, "Nothing in the world can take the place of persistence. Talent will not. There is nothing more common than unsuccessful men with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Education will not. The world is full of educated derelicts. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent." I want you to know that I did not Google quotes on persistence and determination prior to coming down and speaking with you because of what you've been through since Hurricane Ike. That is one of my favorite quotes. That's one of my favorite quotes. It's a quote that I share every time I speak with a group. It's near and dear to my heart. Now, certainly, it's a real pleasure for me to share that quote with you in this room today because of what you've been through. You embody that. You've lived it. You've felt it. I have no doubt you're a very educated bunch of people. I have no doubt that the amount of talent within these walls and within these bigger walls is probably unfathomable to a guy like me of modest intelligence. But it's the persistence and the determination that really have you where you are today, where you came from, and have you where you're ultimately going to be in the future. So, my talent was a lot more along the lines of all conference than it was all world. One of the things that I've heard more times than, quite frankly, I care to acknowledge or admit is something along, when I meet somebody for the first time, "Oh, you're Casey FitzRandolph, it's good to meet you. I didn't recognize you, I'm sorry, you looked a lot bigger on TV." And as a, you know, trying to be world-class athlete, you know, at that time in his, you know, mid to late 20s into his 30s, prime of his career, it didn't sit real well with me. But after I heard it over and over and over again, the day came, or the evening, that I had to take a good long look in the mirror, quite frankly, and say, "You know what, FitzRandolph? They're right. You're 5 feet 11. You're a 180 on a good day, soaking wet. You aren't the biggest guy out there. You're not the fastest, or I shouldn't say fastest, you were. You're not the biggest guy out there. You weren't the quickest. You weren't the strongest. You didn't have a lot of these traits that some of your competitors had. But you did figure out a way to be one of the best." It was a persistence and a determination that were a key and that took me through my 20-some years of ups and downs and ultimately led to my ultimate success. Ralph Waldo Emerson, he said, "What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us." I like that one because it makes me question what percent of our brain we use. Even really smart folks like you. What percent of our brain do we use? I mean, who's heard a percentage? Throw out a number at me. 10. Okay, I hear 10 fairly often. I certainly don't know what the answer is, but I'm going to suggest that if it's 10, or even if it is 20, we've got just a little bit of room for improvement in there in between the years, right? It's the same thing in sports. What was a world record 20 years ago and my record's going to be broken sometime as well. What were records one day, you know, are oftentimes 20th place, thanks for coming, better luck next time results nowadays. We keep improving as a society. It was my belief, not in Casey Fitz, all world, you know, God's gift from a talent perspective. As I said, it was very modest that led me to the gold. But it was Casey Fitz, my belief as a human being, as literally a member of our race, that was the other key to my success, along with persistence. I just really, truly believe in the bottom of my heart that we all underachieve. We all have potential, the likes of which we may never fulfill. But if we recognize that there's a lot of room in between those ears, or that there's a lot of room, you know, in this heart, we're going to get a whole lot further than if we fail to recognize that. We need to dream big. It's healthy to dream big. You know, when I talk about world records and, you know, and how much room we have there and what's you know, in our minds, the other thing that I wanted to ask you is, you know, what in the world were you doing before Hurricane Ike came through? Like, you've done a lot since, right? It's amazing. I mean, Donna sent me blogs and articles, etc., on all of the success and the rebuilding and the persistence and the community that and the state, everybody that's been behind it, and the miracles that have taken place, really, over the past roughly half dozen years. And it made me wonder what you people were doing prior to that storm coming through. I'm teasing you, of course, but my point is, sometimes we don't know what we really have in here and in here until we're challenged, the likes of which we've never been challenged before. So there are, if we're honest, a million ingredients that go into perfection. And I used to ask, raise your hand if you're perfect, but invariably I'd get a couple of smart alecks to raise their hand. So I no longer ask. I just tell you, you're far from perfect. And that's not bad, because so am I. And what that means for all of us is that because our competitors, our peers, and the rest of this world is not perfect, we have a fighting chance. It's not a matter of who's perfect. It's not a matter of who has all of those ingredients, like cooking and good food, of which we found some already down here. It's more a matter of who has the right ingredients, right? It's not the most. It's not a matter of how much we throw in that skillet. It's a matter of what goes into that skillet. And the good Lord gives each of us plenty of ingredients. We need to figure out how to bring them together and what to make of them. So my story started at age four, just about turning five in Madison. When I was playing hockey and I decided I want to be a speed skater, I want to go to the Olympics and do what Eric Heiden did. And I heard that ad on the radio for the Madison All-City Speed Skating Meet to take place at the Frozen Lagoon next to the zoo. And I went out that weekend, and there were no other 4 or 5 year old boys, but there were some 6 and 7 year olds, so they let me skate with a little bit older guys, and I had some success. I beat them. And what does that mean? They may have been on, you know, figure skates with toe picks, and I was on hockey skates, so, you know, I stayed on my feet, I don't know what that means. But I had a little bit of success. And what I can tell you is it was about 3 weeks later that the 1980 Olympics took place in Lake Placid when Eric Heiden won every event, all 5 Olympic gold medals. And the coach of the Madison Club had been a coach of Heiden's, because he too was from Madison. And the coach told my folks, as the video said, you have the next Eric Heiden here. Well, they believed it, and as a, you know, turning 5-year-old, why wouldn't I believe it, right? He's from Madison, he did it. I just beat a couple of kids stumbling, you know, over themselves out there, so I'm off to the races. How could I not be? So I was off to the races in sorts, and that first year, I won my first major title in the world of speed skating. When I became the 1980 Wisconsin State Indoor Champion in the Tiny Tot Men's Division. I mean, God forbid they call it Tiny Tot Boys, right? tiny top man I was. But I was the fastest tiny top man in the state. So I was off to the races, and I felt like a man. Well, I continued to skate, and at the age of 12, I won my next major title when I became the national champion of the 11 and 12-year-olds, and that meant I was the national champ in the midget men's division. So I was moving up in the world, and I can't tell you, I can't tell you a thing about any of the races that I skated that weekend to become, you know, national champ. I can tell you the competition was in Chicago. And the one memory that I have of that weekend was the van, you know, back, I was born in 75, this was 87. And back then, you remember the big custom vans that everybody used to drive? You know, they'd have the curtains and the swivel bucket seats in back, and we didn't have DVDs in there, but you had the table, you know, with the cup holders and plenty of room to fight with your sister and no seatbelts, you know, required. So it's a different world. Anyway, we're coming back up the interstate, I-90, from Chicago to Madison this sunny Sunday March afternoon. And my folks were eternally optimistic, as you saw in the video. And they had made, unbeknownst to me, thank goodness, a couple of signs, posters, just in case Casey won that weekend. And they, in blue and red letters, and I can see it plain as day, and they put them up in the rear side windows of the van as we came back up I-90. Casey FitzRandolph, national champ, 1987 midget men. So, you know, we got some funny looks that day coming back up I-90 from Chicago. Go figure. I continued, and about that time, I remember having a short track skating, speed skating practice in a hockey rink. And we were doing drills down on one end of the rink. And the other end, because we were only doing drills on the one end skating, and then we'd coast on the other end, they had left, which was a mistake, the Zamboni doors to the ice rink open. And I did my drill one time that evening around the far end and came back and was coasting, but still going, you know, whatever we go, 20 miles an hour, and slipped and fell. And I went out. I went out through the Zamboni doors, but I caught my back right on the corner there where the doors were open and kind of wrapped my back around it. And I didn't break anything, but I got a trip to the ER, and my back has never been the same since. So that was my first kind of setback in the world of speed skating. I rebounded, and at the age of 14, I won another national championship in the juvenile men's division, and then went on to win the North American Championships that year in the juvenile men's division as well, a title that had eluded me back in the midget men category. I had, you know, this eternal confidence, and I won, you know, when I won that first national title as a midget man, I was going up to Canada, and I thought, you know, geez, I'm the fastest kid in the greatest country on earth. What are a few, you know, Eskimos going to teach me about speed skating? I call them Eskimos in fun because some of our very best friends and two of the three guys that stood up in our wedding are Canadians, so I don't mean that in a bad way at all, believe me. I learned that those Eskimos, my best friends, knew a thing or two about ice and about speed skating. Go figure. But as I said, 2 years later at age 14, I got it right. North American champion. Age 16 comes along, and I got to go to Europe for the first time, and I was the fastest kid in North America. What were a few Europeans going to be able to teach me about speed skating? Well, we went over to Italy that time, and I can't tell you what place I got. It must have been second. That's a joke. But I can tell you I came back a little more humble in realizing that the Europeans who invented the sport knew a thing or two about it as well. So I skated some more in and around the country and North America. I had another crash during which I took a few chips off of my kneecap and tore my medial collateral ligament, partial tear of my ACL, my anterior cruciate, and spent a lot of time flutter kicking in with kickboards in the pool and eventually working my way back up. At age 19, shortly after I graduated high school, I went over to Europe As a member of my first real United States speed skating team, I was one of three young men along with three young ladies to comprise our junior world team. And what that meant was I was going to be skating against the three best, fastest young men from, you know, any country on earth that was going to send them. And the competition was to be held in Berlin, Germany. What used to be East Berlin, it had just become unified within a couple of years prior to that, I believe. So we go over to Berlin, and the 500-meter race was my strongest distance. I had skated the fastest 500-meter of any junior man in the world that year by 6/10 of a second, which is light years in speed skating terms. So I was the best 500-meter, you know, junior in the world. And it wasn't going to be a matter of, you know, am I going to win, but it was going to be a matter of how much am I going to win by. So I told myself, all right, FitzRandolph, go out there, skate your race, skate smart, don't do anything stupid, don't take chances, don't slip, don't fall, blah, 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 and you will become junior world champion, and the speed skating world will finally recognize that you are coming in terms of, you know, senior category Olympic stuff. I went to the line that weekend. It was a Saturday morning, and I had the good fortune of being partnered with a German skater, so I even had the crowd in my favor to cheer for us. And the gun, the starter says, go to the start. So we go up to the line. He says, ready. We get down. The gun goes off, bang, and we take off. And we get down the opening 100 meters, around the first 100-meter turn, down the back stretch. We're on a big 400-meter oval now. Around that last turn, which can be the most difficult part of a race because you're at about 40 miles an hour, and down the home stretch we go. No falls, not even a slip. I cross the finish line. I look up at this, I can picture it so clear, this huge scoreboard at the end of this cold steel hall of a building in Berlin, Germany. C. FitzRandolph, USA, sixth place. That one hurt. That one I remember. I had come to arguably the most important day of my life, certainly from my perspective, and I had failed to go for it. I had let a fear of failure dictate my day and therefore my result. And it was a painful lesson, but it was a lesson that I vowed to take with me for the rest of my life. I said, Casey, don't ever let a fear of failure chart your course in life again. If there is ever a time in your life, a moment in your life that matters to you, recognize that there's a chance that you could fall, you could slip, but then set it aside and focus on the what-ifs in a positive way. So I came back from Berlin, Germany, not being junior world champ, but having 4 years until my first Olympic Games was to take place in Nagano, Japan in 1998. And I set goals. I wanted to be top 20 in the world the first year. I wanted to be top 10 in the world the second, top 5 overall in the world the year before the Olympics so that I could be on the podium in Nagano, Japan in 98. And things could not have gone more according to script. I was 19th overall that first year as a senior. I was 9th overall the following year. I was 3rd overall in the world the 97 season, having skated the fastest time of any man in the 1,000 meters, so the best at that race. And I was 21 years old. My learning curve was still like this. And the other couple top guys in the world, they were 27 to 30, so they were kind of here. And it was, sounds like a broken record, not a matter of whether I was going to win a medal in Nagano, but how many and what color were they going to be. There was one curveball, one more curveball, and that was called the clap skate. The video mentioned the clap skate, and it was a new technology introduced by the Dutch. They came out with it and got on them about 10 months prior to the 98 Olympics. This is a clap skate. You can see why. Yes, it was very annoying even to speed skaters like myself. But it was also very fast. You had to get on them. They were so much faster than a traditional ice skate. that, you know, that 1,000-meter best in the world time I'd skated the year before would have given me about 25th place 1 year later at the Olympics. So you had to get on him. Well, the problem was the Dutch didn't want me on him. We finally got a pair from Easton Aluminum here in the U.S. about 6 weeks before the Olympics. I should say I finally got a pair. My teammates could get them. They tried to order them for me, even. But the factory in the Netherlands that designed them and made them, they knew the combination of the boot size, the shoe size that I was, the blade size, and the type of metal and steel that I used in my blade. So I couldn't get a pair until 6 weeks prior. And it cost me. Sixth in the 500 meters in Nagano, seventh in the 1,000. Not the results that I had gone over there hoping for. And as I walked away from Japan, I told myself, well, I say this kind of tongue-in-cheek, but you failed again, FitzRandolph. So we've got two options. One is to say, well, geez, you know, maybe what you considered your destiny isn't really your destiny. Maybe it's time to move on. The other option was to say, well, you put in an awful lot of work at this point. It didn't work when you wanted it to, but maybe there are more lessons yet to be learned. And maybe we can come back stronger than we ever were. So I chose the latter, and I walked away from Japan having recognized two things. One, sixth and seventh place were, quite frankly, a lot better results than I probably had any business attaining on those new skates. And so I convinced myself, whether right or wrong, that I used all that energy surrounding the Olympics, all of those butterflies that come to us in the moment of truth, in a positive light, to really have a good performance versus a negative one. I knew that first Olympic experience would stick with me in 2002 and 2006. The other thing that I recognized was that while I was sixth in the 500, every country is allowed to enter up to four skaters. The Canadians were 2, 3, 4, and 5. So every one of them beat me. And these were guys that I'd been skating against, you know, for decades. And I said, well, there is no way those guys should all be beating me. It's these skates and blah, blah, blah. What are they doing up there? So I made a call that very next summer, and I said, can I come up? I'd like to skate with you. And I expected a response along the lines of, well, you can go fly a kite. We finally got you where we want you. No thanks. And what I heard was a response that also helped shape my life. The response that I got a week later, after they had taken some time to talk amongst themselves, each other, their national team coach, the program director, was, come on up, Casey. We think it'll be a win-win. I got up there questioning why in this individual black and white clock doesn't lie endeavor that I was a part of, these guys would invite me, they're one of their biggest competitors, up to teach me how they were using this new technology and what they were doing. I walked away 4 years later, after Salt Lake City, with a gold medal, yes, but with a new understanding of teamwork and of how, again, regardless of what we're doing, regardless of how individual we may feel our endeavors are, how important it is to have a team around us. These guys took me in, and they didn't just take me in. They shared. I mean, they shared their secrets. This is what I'm thinking when I'm at this part of my push, Casey. This is what I'm thinking at the end of my push. This is what I'm thinking when I'm setting up that last turn. This is what I'm thinking when I'm in the ready position, anticipating that gun going off. All of those things, those intangibles, they shared. And when I asked them a couple years later, after I'd been up there for a couple years, why did you guys, I get why you had me up, but why did you share the way you've shared? They both, and I had two separate conversations with the two guys that I trained with day in and day out. They both said, almost verbatim, the exact same thing. They said, Casey, we recognize that we're going to make you better. We'd be fools to think otherwise. But we also recognize that over time you would make us better. And they said, I'm not in this for a gold medal. I'm in this to see whether I can reach my full potential. And quite frankly, Casey, regardless of how much I help you, you help me, etc., if we work together on this, the three of us, we're all going to elevate one another to be better than the rest of the world. And if I skate, if I put together the perfect race, the race that I know I can execute if the stars align, the results, they take care of themselves. I don't need to worry about how fast you skate or how fast Mikey or Jared skates. It'll all take care of itself. It's really just a matter of helping one another reach our full potential. That was, it's a pretty basic, it's a pretty fundamental, you know, statement and philosophy, and yet, you know, to me in that sport, it was really eye-opening. So many times as we go through life on a day-to-day basis, I think we get caught up in everything we have to do on our to-do list, on what our peers and competitors inside and out are doing, and how we rate and how we compare, and what can I do to look a little better than this person or this competitor. I get that. Those are human nature. They're natural tendencies. But it's just also important to recognize that however far we will get on our own accord, looking at our competitors and trying to one-up them, we'll go a lot further if we use them to our advantage and we help them get to their potential. Okay, so after 4 years in Canada, it ended up with a gold medal. And I won that gold medal by 0.03 of 1 second. 0.03 of 1 second, that's what I won by. That's over 2 500-meter races, so really it's over 1,000 meters. Now, you probably saw in the video the race with the other American. I put my hand down in that last turn and saw some goofiness. My point in bringing that up is it never should have been that close. I should have dominated, but he kicked his cone in my lane and he almost made me fall. My other point in sharing that is that I was very blessed to end up on the right side of 0.03 of a second and have a good day on the right day. At the end of the day, the truth of the matter also is we're not going to win every time. We're not. Pick a guy, Michael Jordan, Tiger Woods. Pick a different endeavor. I don't care who you are and what you're doing. Nobody wins every time. But if we follow our passions and we face our fears, eventually we'll get there. And if we do it with a dogged persistence, a literal refusal to give up, regardless of obstacle, we'll get there a lot more often than not. We've got to believe, and we've got to be persistent. I want to leave you with a quote on my fridge. It's from Teddy Kennedy. He said, "Some people see things as they are and ask why. I dream of things that never were and ask, why not?" Take that with you if you would. You've achieved extraordinary things down here already. And against all odds. I mean, odds the likes of which virtually none of your peers have to face. And yet, look at where you are. It's not every day that I get to stand up in front of a group, you know, with the admiration and the awe that I have for you collectively. It's usually just Casey Fitz telling people how to live their life and be successful. I mean, there's an element of joke to that. But you impress me. What you've been through, what you've accomplished, and where you're headed. Thanks so much for having me. I'm going to be out, outside in the hall. I have, it's not in there, it's right here. I brought, in addition to the trophy that I showed in my skate, I have a skin suit and an Olympic torch, And then I brought my medal as well, so I'm happy to give anybody that would like, that hasn't seen it earlier in the day, or if you want to see it again, an up-close look at my medal. All right, Donna, thanks again. We have... This is a skin suit, a racing suit. When you were talking about your ice skating days, I almost stood up and commented on, you know, I have a skin suit if you'd like. You won't find me in it anymore either, for the record. So it's a skin suit, and, you know, you can see how comfortable it might be when you put it on, particularly if you're a man. Just saying. The irony, you know, all right, so they got to be fast, right? Which means they have to be aerodynamic. You don't want anything flapping in the breeze, including your suit. And they used to be 100% spandex. So at least then they stretched. But now they've, as of right around 2001, they changed the bulk of the design to like a rubber that doesn't stretch very much. So it's less comfortable. It's made, you know, it's not made to fit standing up, needless to say, duh, but it's got to, you know, fit you when you're in this position, and not just fit, but still be very snug, right, without, you know, a lot of seams and flaps. So this is a racing suit. It has, you know, it was worn in World Cups and World Championships, not the Olympics, because I wouldn't be allowed to have a sponsor logo or two on there. But otherwise, it's the exact same suit that the team and I wore in the 2002 Olympics. So, a few show-and-tell items. I would love to answer any questions that anybody in the audience may have. And there's... Oh, wow. Good morning. No, I'm kidding. And there is, there's nothing off limits. So don't be bashful, don't be shy. It's unlikely you'll throw me for a curveball, although it's possible. Does anybody have anything they want to know about life as an Olympian? Yes?
Describe a training schedule for a week.
Describe a training schedule for a week. So 6 days a week we train. Let me back up. We train about 11 months out of the year, so the season will end in the middle of March, and we'll take off until we'll rest until about the middle of April, 3 weeks maybe. We'll ease back into things, but by, you know, the end of May through the end of March, it's 6 days a week. Five of those days will be 2-a-days, and then the sixth will only be one workout. And then the seventh will be a travel, well, either a rest day or during the competitive season, a travel day. So... one of those workouts will probably be on the ice. We'll be at the rink from about, you know, when you include warm-up, you know, jogging, stretching, cycling, you know, so on. That's 45 minutes, and then you're on the ice for 2 hours, and then 45 minutes cool down. And then you're maybe getting some hot-cold therapy in the different, you know, tubs, or massage therapy, etc. And then you'll grab a bite of lunch and relax for a couple hours, and then 3 to 5:30 will be the afternoon workout. And then, you know, it's dinner. So it's a lot of training, it's a lot of eating, and it's a lot of sleeping. Yeah.
That was just a few months after 9/11 when you won the medal. Patriotism was at an all-time high. How did it feel to be up there when the national anthem was playing? And what was going through your mind as you were trying to sing the words to the Star-Spangled Banner?
Yeah, it's a great question, Dave. You know, I thought that... I always thought I'd watch, you know, Bonnie Blair and Dan Jansen win their medals and some of my heroes, and I'd get a little bit sentimental even watching them, so I thought I would just stand up there and, you know, tears running down my face. And it started to have that effect on me, but then I just got relieved. Like, thank God that, you know, I had finally accomplished what I'd always thought I could, but never knew for sure I would. And then I became thankful that I was on the right side of 300ths of a second, you know, had a good day on the right day, all of those things. It just flat out excited. And then I would be proud of two things I remember distinctly. One, very proud of being an American. And then a pride that, you know, our country had these precious minutes of, you know, global display of patriotism and I'll say power. And then also proud of what I had gone through, you know, to win that medal. As I mentioned, it was ironic, you know, in order to win the gold medal, it had to actually become not about the gold medal, but rather about things like, you know, execution and the journey and, you know, all these other things, and let that take care of itself. So all of those things and a thought of, now what? Because from the time I was 4 years old, my life was about that piece of metal. And now that they put it around my neck, what am I going to do? And yeah, okay, so fine, I'm going to go get rich and famous and never have to lift another finger, which didn't exactly pan out. right. And beautiful women will come flocking, oh, I already had one. yeah, but, you know, but it, to be serious, you know, so now what am I going to do with the rest of my life that's going to fulfill me the way, you know, that endeavor did? And I remember thinking, I feel like I just climbed the highest mountain in the world, you know, as a mountain climber. What do you do next? What is your goal? You know, or I found the proverbial pot of gold at the end of the rainbow that I'd been searching for, never knew for sure existed, finally found it, but now what do you do? So it was all of those feelings, I mean, literally and plain as day, all of those feelings went through my head two times, and then the national anthem was over. Yeah. And I hadn't expected that. Yeah.
Get over those doubts. What kind of thoughts went through your head?
Yeah, what kind of self-talk did I give myself to go? I saw a lot of shrinks. And I'm only half joking. The only part of that I'm joking about is the shrinks tab. I really did work with psychologists, and they helped. But I was never the most confident athlete. I mean, a lot of athletes are, I would tell you, confident to a fault. They're kind of brash, cocky, arrogant, and so on. And I mean, I guess it's part of the nature of, we're trying to conquer other people physically, right? And so maybe that just breeds that mentality. But I always struggled with that. And in fact, I always struggled with a sense of entitlement, meaning I was challenged to feel as though I deserve to win, you know, this weekend as much as anybody else. I don't know why. I went through the same, you know, training, etc. It wasn't like I didn't work as hard. Maybe it was because I was aware of how average I was. But I worked with some psychologists here and there as I needed them when I had, you know, more doubts. I surrounded myself with good people. I mean, good fast skaters, but also just good people. And same thing from a coaching perspective, very good coaches that were good people and cared, you know, about me as a person. And then, quite frankly, I found strength in my faith, particularly as I, you know, got into my senior/Olympic years. And I recognized that, you know, as I mentioned, what's worst case? Well, worst case is, you know, I trained my entire life for this. I go out, I fall flat on my face. I don't win a gold medal, and then I'm a normal human being, you know? Is that really that awful? The sun's going to come up. Mom's still going to love me. You know, hopefully if Jen wasn't, you know, digging gold all this time, she still will too. And so once you kind of, you know, once you accept the possibilities of worst case, then you're able to focus on the positives and work towards them. Yeah, it's a great question. Did my faith help, you know, keep positive in light of in the face of the collapse gate versus kind of letting that snowball into pessimism? And it's a really good question. Here's what I can tell you. I did pout over those skates, okay? I did say, why? This is so not fair. They should be waiting till after the Olympics so we all have 4 years to get ready, not, you know what I mean? All of those things. And so I had a bit of an internal pity party. I'm not very good at embracing change either. So, I mean, that's a weakness of mine. And yet, you know, even for those of us that aren't very good at embracing change, the fact of the matter is, change happens, and it happens over and over and over as we go through life, right? Regardless of endeavor. So even if we don't necessarily genetically embrace it and love it, You know, I wish I was still on a, you know, a regular cell phone, you know, never mind touch phones and blah, blah. But we, you know, you do it. You either do it or you're left behind. And so I had the little pity party, and then I said, well, again, I was never very good at throwing the towel, and I was never very good at cutting my losses. So I'd said, FitzRandolph, you kicked your own rear end for 20-some years already. Why would you give up now? I mean, the next Olympics are going to be in the U.S. in 4 years. What can you do to put every odd, every percent in your favor? And that turned me to looking up at Canada and, you know, giving up maybe a little more hunting and fishing on my rest day to really have my legs up and rest. Every little detail that I could think of. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, let's give Casey another round of applause. Thank you so much. A few logistics for those of you who were mentioned in the various recognitions. If you wouldn't mind coming up to the front, we're going to take a picture of you all with Casey. And then he's going to be out in the hall signing poster cards if you'd like to have a personalized poster card or one for your kids. Thank you.
UTMB Health. Working together to work wonders.